This is Found You, Rylie Wolf, FBI Suspense Thriller, Book 1, written by Molly Black, narrated by Megan Kinder. Chapter 1. It all came down to this. 3 months of round-the-clock investigations. Thousands of false leads. Gallons upon gallons of coffee consumed. All of it with the promise of one thing. To bring this mean son of a bitch, a man who'd terrorized an entire community for months, down. Now it was time to make good on that promise. Cloaked in darkness under a non-working streetlight at the corner of a run-down section of town outside of Seattle, Rylie Wolf waited for her target to appear. He'd been in there, in his house, for hours, ever since she'd followed him and his all-blue minivan back from his job at Beaver Lake Elementary School. What was he doing? Instinctively, she reached into her pocket and pulled out her cell phone, lifting it up and tapping the display. The screen was black, the battery dead. Of course, she got like that sometimes, so focused on a case that even the most essential acts of daily living escaped her. She'd forgotten to plug her phone into the car charger on the way. Son of a bitch. So much for calling for backup. Just as she made the decision to move closer so that she could venture a look in the windows, the garage door slowly lumbered up. From her vantage point, she could just see inside. Nothing concerning, just the back end of the blue van with the Washington license plate. The ignition coughed and fired, the red tail light switched on, and the car slowly began to pull out. Then suddenly, it lurched to a stop. Rylie squinted, trying to see better in the darkness. The single light in the garage bay illuminated the face of one Edison Blaze in the side-view mirror. He was tough, mean, and ugly, the type of guy you wouldn't want to meet in a dark alley. No clue on why the administration had decided it was a good idea to take him on as janitor at the elementary school. If Rylie had her way, soon they'd all be regretting that hire. Very soon. Clean record, my ass. Someone had fudged those files, big time. She watched as he moved in the darkness. He seemed to be wrestling with something in the back seat. It was just a flash, no more than that. But for a brief instant she thought she saw, in silhouette, a tiny hand pressed up against the side window. Christopher. The world spun, her head rushed in a whirlwind, eyes clouding over, breath quickening. This was it. Fingers wrapped around the useless phone, spreading white at the knuckles. She took one unsteady step forward, her sneaker hitting the dewy, slippery grass of the lawn. Okay, think, Rylie, be calm about this. You can't afford to make any mistakes. She touched her left hand to her pocket to make sure her car keys were still there. She glanced at her pickup across the street, trying to decide if she should make a break for it now. It was her private vehicle, so she didn't have a radio in there to call for help, but if she made it there, she could peel out and follow him. Or she could end it. Right here, right now. Meanwhile, still halfway out the garage door, the car's driver's side door opened and out popped the substantial form of Edison Blaze. Hiking up his sagging jeans, he went back into the house. In that moment, she made her decision. Grabbing her Glock, she moved forward, pausing at the back of the van, her gun pointed at the slightly open inside door from the garage to the house. She peered into the window but saw nothing beyond the darkened pane. When he appeared in the doorway, he didn't see her at first, as he must have been blinded by the headlights shining in his face. He was carrying a paper lunch bag. He took a few steps toward her, oblivious. She pointed her gun at her suspect.
Freeze! FBI!
The man did no such thing. Somehow, she'd known it wouldn't be that easy. Edison Blaze had a long list of arrests, but no convictions. He was used to evading blame. Not this time. She was determined to make sure of that. Without hesitation, he jumped into the minivan and it lurched back again. She dove away, narrowly missing the van's rear bumper as it barreled out under a streetlight, revealing him completely. There was a sheen of sweat on his forehead, a wild look in his eyes. Black hair fanned over his forehead like splayed fingers. She scrabbled to her feet and headed for her pickup. Jumping in, she punched the gas, tearing onto the road and giving chase. It was after midnight, so the roads were empty. A light turned red just as she was approaching it. She paused but did not stop as she sailed through the intersection, spotting Blaze making a right on Sammamish Pike, headed for Interstate 86, the main drag around these parts. Was that where he was heading? It made sense. If he wanted to get out of town, out of the country, quick, that was the easiest way. Headed west, it went all the way to the Canadian border. And if so, she knew a shortcut. It paid to have lived here in the suburbs of Seattle for the past 16 years. From her research, she'd seen that Blaze was a drifter. He'd been making his way up the western seaboard, from Mexico to California to Oregon to Washington, leaving a path of unsolved child abductions along the way. Rylie had connected Blaze to a man in Mexico who'd sell kids for top dollar to bidders who'd use them for a variety of shady things. Now he'd brought his reign of terror to Washington. And it ends here, she thought, pressing on the gas and taking Southeast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.